Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
The screen is visible to you all. Okay, so today, myself, Professor Joyjit Chakraborty from the Bhavanipur Education Society College, along with Dr. Abhijit Pandit from Amity University, are going to speak on the evolving dimensions of teaching and learning in the post-pandemic era, a critical review. So I would also like Professor Dr. Abhijit Pandit to speak few words.
Okay. Hello, everyone. So today we are going to speak on a topic which is a very, very important topic in the present era. So we are going to say something on the various, problems which, online teaching and learning, is posing, on the teacher and the student fraternity. So how is that, a big issue in the present era? So that is what we are going to discuss today. Okay, the various pros and cons of online teaching. So I myself, Dr. Abhijit Pandit from Assistant Professor, Amity University, Kolkata. So along with me, we are lucky to have Professor Joyjit Chakraborty, who is from a full-time lecturer from Bhavanipur Education Society College, Kolkata. We are both from Kolkata. So definitely in our presentation, we'll be having some issues from Kolkata itself, but we try to be, pan-India, pan-world. We will take the issues, the global, local and global issues, which we are going to face in online in teaching and learning. So Joyjit, sir, you can just proceed, sir.
Okay. So I shall now proceed with the presentation. As Dr. Abhijit Pandit clearly pointed out, that today we are going to talk about how the methodologies of teaching and learning has evolved from the traditional forms to the online forms, and how this entire change in the methodology is affecting higher education, both in India as well as in the global context. So to start with, throughout our presentation, let me tell you that it is not really absolutely theoretical, but at the same time, I have done a thorough literature review pertaining to different aspects of online teaching and what other authors have to say as far as this methodology is concerned. Now, before I go to the pedagogy of online teaching, let me just start my presentation by giving you a basic overview regarding this COVID-19 pandemic and how this COVID-19 pandemic not only became a public health issue, but also how it is influencing, or rather I would say how it is impacting the various dimensions of employment, education, agriculture, and other spheres of the world economy. So we can observe that today we are speaking about pandemic and economy. There is one section of people who are advocating lockdown to happen. There is another section of people who are of the opinion that lockdown cannot continue for a long time, because if it continues for a prolonged period, it might affect the economy and it might affect jobs, and specifically those people who are the daily wage earners in a country like India. So you can see two schools of thought prevailing today as far as this COVID-19 pandemic is concerned. And those two schools of thought are basically looking up to this problem from both public health issue angle as well as the economic angle. Now, one of the key sectors which has been thoroughly impacted by this COVID-19 pandemic is the higher education sector. So when I talk about the higher education sector, it talks about universities, it talks about colleges, and it also talks about tertiary education as well. So throughout our presentation, me and my co-presenter, we both are going to talk on how this pandemic has shaped the very forms of education across universities, colleges, and other forms of higher education. So you can see, after doing a thorough literature review, it has been found that based on the panel data of 60 countries for the period between 1995 and 2002, it has been found that there is a positive effect resulting from the spread of the internet get subdued, or less if income equality accompanies it, which is probably going to be the condition for the most developing countries. I think there is a marked difference between the developed and the developing countries. If we talk about a country like India, which is still at a very developing stage, we can find that there is a large section of people who cannot afford to have online education. Though they might be brilliant students, or they might be absolutely interested in having education, but somehow or the other they are deprived of the same because of the simple fact that they might not have good internet access, or they might not have laptops or smartphones back at their home. So I think in a way, in a developing country like India, this entire mechanism of online education has been creating a digital divide. And this particular topic I'll take on later, because in my presentation I have also spoken about the concept of digital divide. So in a country like India, online education will forever remain a big, big challenge. So according to UNESCO, there have been 1.3 billion learners across the world who are not able to attend school or universities as of March 23rd, 2020. So you can see this number is huge. This number is basically huge. And the current UNESCO statistics put this figure even more, which stands at 1.5 billion. So you can well imagine that 1.5 billion students or learners around the world were not being able to attend school or university. So this is a very severe figure, or this would rather come to you as a big shock. Next, in our study, we basically wanted to achieve few important objectives. First, how this COVID-19 pandemic has impacted higher education, and this sudden shift from education from the offline mode to the online mode. Next, in our study, as I have just mentioned, that we have tried to explore the issues of social justice in the context of digital divide in India. So this digital divide and social justice, this is also a very key concern. And based on a thorough review and consideration of quality information, we have also posed various arguments throughout the paper. So any kind of, our presentation is something which is not only related to facts and figures, but at the same time, it is bound to trigger questions in your mind. And why I'm saying so? That you would realize after our presentation gets over. So we will be throwing a question which is bound to make you think. So response to the COVID pandemic by various universities. So you can see that since we are talking from the global perspective, there are some universities in Australia, like Monash University or Victoria University, which have temporarily stopped their learning to design online learning. Because in order to shift from this traditional mode to online mode, this is a very slow and steady process. So this cannot be achieved within a fortnight. So you can see a reputed university like Monash University or a Victoria University, they have rather done a very good thing, that they have temporarily stopped their learning in order to carefully design online mode of learning. So what they have done is, I would say, a very rational decision. And by doing this, they are only going to achieve long-term objectives. So in short term, their strategies might look a bit more regressive in nature, but from the long-term point of view, I think this is going to reap them huge dividends. You can also see that universities of, like University of Queensland, continued face-to-face learning with physical distancing protocol with online recordings. So though we are observing online education all over the world, but at the same time, a university which is as big as the University of Queensland still continued to advocate on the concept of face-to-face learning with online recordings. So this is nothing but a blended form of learning, which we are talking right now. So how can we do a proper mix of both online teaching as well as offline teaching in order to propound the blended form of learning, which is going to further benefit the students. And there are few facts and figures as well. For example, China's Ministry of Education declared on 28 January that this would extend to all schools and universities and standardized tests like GMAT, GRE, IELTS, etc. So you can see that online education is not only restricted to schools and universities, but also for various preparatory exams, for management exams like GRE, GMAT, IELTS, and TOEFL, etc., etc. You can see that there has been a big influence of online learning on these verticals as well. Now, there are a few other informations as well. For example, in India, all academic activities were suspended as per the direction of the UGC, and examinations were postponed. And if you follow the yesterday's news, again, the 12th standard exams have been rather cancelled due to this ongoing pandemic situation. And also various central universities like University of Hyderabad had to stop their academic activities. And also some private universities like SRM University of Science and Technology or WIT, which is located in Vellore, declared the summer vacations for students. Also some renowned universities like Harvard or MIT had decided to move completely online from 23rd March 2020 onwards. Now, these are the universities which can afford to go to online mode and implement that in a very effective manner, because these are the universities which belong to the top three in the world. So being the best universities in the world, they are also adopting best practices. And if we can see that there have been a gradual transition from offline to online mode right from 23rd March 2020. And it was also reported that 5%, that is 260 out of 5,300 higher education institute in the US could shift to online instruction with minimum online on-campus presence, and more higher education institute have made this transition to online mode. Now, what is the difference between this content delivery and learning? So how can we balance these two? Now, though there are lots of effort being made in order to ensure that there is no loss in the academic year, and at the same time maintaining the safety protocol, you can see, or rather India has observed in the past 1.5 years, that there have been schools and colleges have been suspended. Every form of learning has taken the online route. And also, as an academician, I can say that the seminars or the workshops or the conferences which we attend on a regular basis, these have also taken a backseat owing to this ongoing pandemic. So these seminars, conferences, and workshops are also happening online. And this has changed the entire rhythm of education and teaching learning procedures. So these are few more information being reported by Hindu on April 14, 2020 regarding the curriculum and assessment, and how this entire redesigning of teaching and learning would usher a new dimension in the world of education. Now, the bigger question is, are the students ready to accept this teaching learning process, or do you need to adopt a different mode? As a country, are we really equipped, or are we really resourceful in order to implement all these things? That remains a bigger question. So the focus is not on delivering the content, but also ensuring effective opportunity. See, there's a difference between learning and effective learning. We can learn from any source, but how much effective it is, the effectiveness of that learning is something which is more important. Now, many students might be sitting in front of a laptop and they might be adopting online education. But how far this methodology is impacting their mind and how far it is really benefiting them, that would remain a big, big question. So this, with passage of time, will realize that how this online education has really benefited the student community at large. Now, the impact of COVID-19 on higher education. I would now request Dr. Abhijit Pandit to speak on these issues further.
Thank you, Joyjit sir. Okay, so very nicely you have given an introduction to this topic. So I'll just continue from here where you left. Okay, you can see on the screen, how can this particular education, new education policy, so what we have, actually framed post-COVID. So what are the salient features and of that policy, and how COVID-19 has actually impacted quality education in the, in the graduation, post-graduation, master, PhD, postdoc and all those levels. So we are trying to highlight all those things. And economic recession could impact higher education in various ways. You can have a look at it, employment opportunity for university graduates who are likely to enter the job market. So are they fully equipped? That's the question. Means all those basic skills, the theoretical, practical, are they getting those adequate skills in order to do some quality jobs? So that is one big question. Okay, so the type of, education which the students get in the offline mode. So is it fully, imparted to the students in the online mode? So that's a big question. So are they fully, placement ready? So that is one question which has to be looked after. The UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs estimate that COVID-19 may cause global economy. So this is one big, concern, one of the biggest concerns. Our, GDP of our country, India has really fallen. So more than, 7%. So in the last year also it has fallen. So that is one area of concern. So overall global, economy has shrunken by 1% or more, so we can have a look at it. So, and while the International Labour, Organization, projects an increase in a global unemployment. So earlier it was 5.3 million. So that is expected to become, more than four times. You can see to 24.7 million. So that is going to happen. And we don't know how long this process will continue. So whether the third wave is going to arrive. So we are predicting that it will cause a lot more havoc than the first two waves. Even there is one thing you have heard of, the black fungus, white fungus, that all things are also going to happen. We don't know what's the end of this particular, situation. So one particular disease is triggering some other diseases also. So as you can see, we don't know how long we will be having all these, problems. The problems are actually cumulative effect. So that will actually, definitely impact our economy. We don't know how long we can have this, but we need to know how to modify. So since we are mostly concerned with the education policy, so can we, suit our education, policy just to, be in tune with the present, situation? So can it be, okay with the present? Can it get adjusted? So can the teacher and the student fraternity can adjust themselves with the existing situation? So what should be the modifications, and how will that actually impact their overall quality of education? So that is also very, very important thing which is has to be taken care of. In up to school and school level, it is fine, but when you move on to the, universities, colleges, higher institutes, so will that particular, level of education, what we actually expect, from those, from this, graduates or post, is that getting imparted? So that's a big question. Even one more thing, it will also trigger some, abnormal, some changes in the students' perspective also. The behavioral point of view also, you have to tackle the issue. How are the students, adapting to this, this, blended learning or, online mode of education? So are they, having those, the acumen to adapt to the changes? That is one thing. Okay, we know that, we have to change, but are you ready for the change? So from the, the teachers have to change, they are given the adequate training from their institutes, but every, institute may not have the right, infrastructure for that of uplift. Are the students, throughout the world, are they having that of resources to adapt to the change? Are they having that mentality to undergo the change? Are they suffering from some depression also? Everyone may not have, as Joyjit sir rightly pointed out that, the digital divide. So it may not be equal, feasible for both all types of people, rich, poor, people, throughout the world. So they may adopt differently for the in the technology. Okay, the rich people, they are more, prone, to adapt to the latest technology, but the poor people, unfortunately, they may not be able to, adapt to the, all the, recent, developments of technology. So that is one big issue which has to be taken care of. So what we actually want to see that, this particular, new education policy may not equally impact everyone, throughout the world. Okay, so equality, right to equality of education. So that actually, that is a biggest question mark right now. So you can see IAU global survey also revealed that almost 80% of the respondents believe that COVID-19 will have an impact on the enrollment numbers, you know, like, you know, the admission count may not, you know, be up to the mark. So that has to fall, because, you know, the students might wait for one or two more years, you know, to enroll, you know, to the offline mode of education rather than taking the online mode of education right now. So that might lead to the decrease in the enrollment number. Almost half, 50% believe that impact will affect both international and local students. Okay, so it's not that, you know, the universities, if they go for the blended learning or the online learning, they will be able to, you know, fulfill the quota of, you know, admit that required number of students, you know, that quota they will definitely fulfill. So that is not, that is again questionable. So they might not be able to get that many number of students which they used to get earlier. So that is definitely going to impact, you know, the admission count of the students. So some higher education institutes, especially private ones, reported that this impact would have negative financial consequences. So one such thing, you know, we can have, you know, like, you know, the teachers, you know, they will be impacted. Okay, the, you know, like, you know, teachers, you know, they expect the increment, you know, on a yearly basis. So that might also be impacted. The various, you know, benefits with the teachers, you know, get. Okay, so even we have heard that many educational institutes, the teachers are not getting the full salary. So they are getting some reduction in the salary. So this is one such impact, you know, on the higher education. Like the teachers might not get that of motivation to give their best. Okay, so that also, you know, you have to, you know, compensate the teaching fraternity, the people who are involved in the education institute. That also, if that particular, you know, monetary incentive is not properly, you know, imparted, you know, as I told you right now, so every faculty may not get the adequate, you know, salary or adequate increment in the salary. So that might definitely demoralize the teachers also. So like, you know, as you can see, the sudden shift to online mode of education, what benefit, you know, what actually there are pros and cons of everything. So we have found that there are more cons than pros. Okay, so with COVID-19, we are seeing how yesterday's disruptors are becoming today's lifeguards. While traditional institutes of once viewed online education as threat, but now we have to, you know, earlier, you know, traditional institutes, you know, that mode of education, so that, you know, they earlier considered online education to be a threat, but now we considered that, you know, online education is no more a threat. It is one mode of you know, like, you know, survival. However, lecturers are still struggling to maintain the same depth of engagement. So this is another issue. Like, you know, how much can we engage the students? So what level of engagement we can have in the offline mode of education, that we are unable to get. So we cannot ensure that, you know, the, like, whatever level of concentration the students used to impart in the class lectures when delivered in the offline mode of education. So are they giving that much of attention? So we cannot ensure. So here the question lies, you know, is the quality of education maintained? So how much are you compromising with the quality of education if you are going for the online mode of education? So that actually has to be taken care of. So there are definitely, we know, there are certain apps, you know, some technology we can take, an artificial intelligence, a lot of things are there, okay, by which you can ensure that the students, the attention level of students are not falling abruptly. So we can ensure that, but how much can we guarantee that the level of attention which the students used to impart earlier in the offline mode of education, that is still intact? Definitely it has deteriorated, but so that is one, you know, issue, you know, which has to be taken care of, you know. So, and we, another thing is that the students might not, you know, lack of attention, you know, even the level of, you know, a student engagement, you know, participation, like in the offline mode of education, so we can form, you know, a lot of clusters within the class, you know, so we can give them some group activities which they can like sit together and, you know, chalk out some plans, they can sort out, you know, they can solve the riddles. So that thing you cannot ensure in that much effectively in the online mode of education. Okay, so these are all things, you know, the student engagement, so that's a big question mark. So how much can we engage the students by this online mode of education? And even we cannot track it also. If the students are showing some sort of, you know, disengagement, so we cannot even track that fully. Okay, in the offline mode of education, if some students are not paying attention, we can track it to some extent, but here it is a big challenge. How the teachers will identify whether the students are fully getting engaged in the class lectures? Next one, please. Okay, so like, you know, as George sir earlier, you know, told you, the digital divide. So like, you know, as I was talking, you know, equality of education, the right to equal education opportunity for all. So that thing is a biggest challenge. So here the problem is caused by digital divide. Digital divide means, you know, like the rich and poor. So like, you know, rich people get access to the latest technology, okay, internet, you know, laptop, smartphone, but can that be accessible to the poor people, like, you know, those who are mostly from the villages? So yes, they might get a smartphone, they may not get a laptop at the same time. You see, it's difficult to do, you know, online classes with a smartphone. Everyone can understand why, because we cannot see the, you know, the whatever there is on the screen, that may not be getting displayed, and even the students have to take note of what is there on the screen of the smartphone. That is not a very feasible solution. So laptop is must for online mode of education. And second issue is that even if the student manages to get a smartphone, then can they have a very sound internet connectivity in our country? You know, like, you know, the internet has not spread uniformly in the entire country. So it has spread more in the cities and towns, metropolitan regions rather than the villages. So here, you know, the students in the villages, even they have a smartphone, they may not have very good adequate internet connectivity, which is a must for online mode of education. That is another thing which has to be taken care of. So this is the thing which is digital divide. You know, Joyjit sir will just, you know, conclude the session. So thank you very much for providing us this wonderful opportunity. So we are privileged to speak in front of the lovely audience. So I think we'll get some food for thought. You know, like, you know, yes, United Nations has already pointed out some, you know, issues, you know, like, you know, guidelines, you know, for sustainable development. So here, you know, this particular education policy also has to be reformed accordingly. So we have to fulfill the goals provided by UN. So in that, one particular goal is also talking about, you know, equality in education. So can that be fulfilled? So what are the issues which you are facing? So Joyjit sir is going to just wrap up the session. So in his own way, over to you, sir.
Okay. So Dr. Pandit has highlighted few very important points with regard to digital divide. And one thing he has correctly pointed out, that even if a certain student get access to all the technological resources, but at the same time, the bigger question remains that whether they have a strong internet connectivity or not. Now, let me share the statistics with you that in the urban context of Kolkata, there have been a study which has been done during the previous year, which has found that even out of the entire urban population in Calcutta, only 43% of people have access to internet back at their home. So in a city like Calcutta, which is a very which basically qualifies to be a metro city, where you can see lots of development taking place in terms of various aspects, but still, if you talk about the internet facility being provided, only 43% of the entire population have access to internet back at their home. So it basically concludes the fact that the rest 57% do not have. So if the overwhelming majority of a certain city does not have access to internet connection, then you can well imagine that what happens to the semi-urban and the rural area. So this is one thing which will take years to solve, because if we want to implement online education as a new normal, then first what we need to ensure is that we need to digitally empower every strata of people. So there will be no difference between rich and poor. Okay, so this is something what we need to first ensure if we want online education to continue in long run. Otherwise, only a certain section will benefit and the other section will forever remain deprived. But as a country, that we should not hope. I do not hope that certain such things happen. So the policy makers of the country need to take some rational measures in order to nullify this difference between digital mode and the traditional mode, and also not to create any discrimination between rich and the poor. So this is something which we need to note. So there are different massive online or open online courses. Have also, if in a country like India, this is very popular, had faced criticisms like the environment of learning is an impersonal nature and students may have to learn largely on their own, which they have raised that this online education mode is something where you do not have personal connectivity with the students. So the amount of learning that we acquire from this platform is also very minimum. So according to Miller 2016, a lot of college students might not have the technical skills. So till now, me and Dr. Pandit has largely spoken about the resources and the internet connectivity. But even the most important question is, how many people around us do have the technical skills to operate a laptop or to operate a smartphone? Okay, so that is also a big question, because everybody may not be digitally proficient in order to handle certain technologies. So there are various issues that still needs to be unraveled. And once we take once we come to a reasonable decision with regard to all these elements, then only we can think of implementing online learning on a larger level. Now, what is a discourse of online teaching and learning? There are various discourses. Now, today, you can see that there are various platforms like Zoom or Google Meet, or you can see WebEx or MS Teams. There are various platforms on which online learning is taking place all over the world. Now, the efficacy of these platforms vary. Some platform might be good, some platform might not be good. And not only teaching and learning is happening through these platforms, but also you can see lots of assignments are given to the students. Lots of quizzes are given to the students. Even I personally teach on Google Classroom as far as my institute is concerned. So there is also a mechanism of taking attendance, online attendance. So once every student joins the classroom, so automatically their names are being recorded in a certain Excel sheet. And without verbally taking the attendance, I can easily download the same and I can submit it to my college authority. So there are various features which are upcoming, and lots of extra addition is also being provided to the existing modes of online learning. So in days to come, we might observe much more innovation in this modus operandi of study, and hopefully this is going to make the teaching and learning experience even better. So I think I have spoken about this, and you know that since it is a virtual mode, there are also various disadvantages. For example, you may not track the students, because in an examination hall, you can simply stand in front of every student and see whether they are cheating from each other or not. But on the online platform, when you take an exam, the scope of doing this thing is very minimum. Though I know that many universities are adopting different methods. Like, for example, I know certain universities where a certain mechanism have been created in order to track the students while they are giving exam by opening the camera, and this can see whether the concerned student is teaching or whether the concerned student is cheating or not. But this cannot be done at a broader level. For example, during the normal course of invigilation, we can stand in front of 150 or 200 students and monitor the entire situation. But here, this monitoring cannot be done to the greatest possible extent. Yes, we can create some ways to monitor the system, but the efficiency and the efficacy of physical invigilation when we do it in our schools or colleges, that can never be replaced in online platform. The digital divide in India, of course, there's a digital divide largely because of the economic condition and also the social status of people. And this entire difference between the rural and the urban area and poor connectivity, as Dr. Pandit has mentioned, and also limited space in the house. This is very important to understand. Many people might not have the necessary infrastructure to sit back at home and learn. For example, poor people who basically lives in a very small house with maybe one room. So in that one room, how can he sit and avail online education? Also, there might be various problems within their family. So to maintain a balance between their personal life and their academic life is a big, big challenge. So these are the key indicators of household social consumption. So you can see that there's been a study done regarding how many people can afford a smartphone or a computer. So a mere 13% of the people surveyed would use the internet. See, in rural areas, only 13% of people are the ones who can actually use the internet. You forget smartphone or computer. Only access to internet is only limited to 13% people. And also, less than 15% of the rural Indian households have internet, as opposed to 42%. See, what I mentioned a few minutes back. In the urban scenario only, 42% or 43% people have internet. Vis-a-vis in the rural area, only 15%. So you can well imagine that how long or how far farther we need to go as a country as far as implementing online education is concerned. So this digital divide, for example, there has been a case in the Indian state of Kerala where a 14-year-old girl committed suicide because she was not able to join online classes. See, the very, very grave situation. A 14-year-old girl, probably she was studying class 7 or class 8, or she committed suicide because she was unable to join online classes. Also, a 16-year-old boy from a poor family took his life because he was not being able to have a smartphone. So these are some of the grave situations. So there are some other incidents as well also happened, like a 10th standard girl student committed suicide in Bali in West Bengal. And because, see, till the time this difference between poor and rich will remain, this kind of incidents is bound to happen, because any poor student cannot afford to have a smartphone or an internet back at their home. So I think we have understood the digital divide. This is a conclusion remark. And we should try to nullify this difference. And we should try to create an atmosphere where every student from different verticals of the society can avail online education. And also as far as the content, as far as the instruction mechanism, and as far as the teaching learning procedure is concerned, we need to keep on improvising on the same. So this is what being mentioned in these slides. So this geographical and financial condition, etc., etc. Technology is an important factor, and good internet connection. And so these are the different things what we need to keep in mind as far as online education is concerned. So we come to the end of the presentation, and what I can say that yes, online education might be a new normal, but in my opinion, in a country like India, which is still at a very developing stage, I think we need to go a long way in effective implementation of the same. So, and specifically during the COVID-19 pandemic, this online education, we do not know how long this pandemic will remain. And till the time pandemic remains, we need to find out some way in order to accommodate students from various backgrounds in this online mode of education. So this is precisely what I had to say. So these are the references from which, these are the sources which I have referred as far as my presentation is concerned. With this, I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you so much for your.
Thank you everyone. So can we just sum up some important, points, like what are must right now? Okay, so, number one, as Jaji sir has told, one is, good internet connectivity is must. Number two, access to, at least, smartphone is must, okay, for the students at least, and the students should also get some loan assistance, for getting smartphone or, laptop, that is must. And also, the mental health of the students also matter, mental health of teachers, students. So counseling session is also must, we have to remain, active. We need to be refresh in mind, okay, we should have minimum amount of stress, and all those things should be there. So we need to do regular counseling session. So behavioral, psychotherapists and all, they must come forward and assist the students.
Another point, sir.
Yes.
We are only talking from the viewpoint of the students.
Yes.
But there are many senior professors.
Yes.
Who cannot use this digital
platform. Yes. So some training facility must be there. Okay. Like, whether within the camp or off campus, on campus, something should be there. Okay. So that, even there must be some interactive session amongst the faculty members, just how to adopt the latest technology, all those things, like as you told, quiz, nowadays, MCQA mode of exam, we are having. So even that, there is an option to check, malpractices, in that MCQ also, we can shuffle the questions, and even the options also, we can shuffle. So that also can be done. Even one more thing, which I might have heard in some schools, they are, making the students sit beside, just on in backside of the student, there is one mirror. And the students have to keep their camera on. So if their students are doing any sort of malpractices, that can be seen through the camera because they have a mirror on the backside. So these all innovative techniques can be there just to remove all sorts of malpractices as much as possible. Because I know it is not perfectly possible, but as much as possible, we should keep our, education system as much, sanctity of the exam system has to be of, every that thing, okay, that it has to be maintained. So that way we can ensure it, because I know this is going to happen even for at least 2-3 more years, the impact of COVID will be there. So we need to adapt quickly. And there are a lot more things which we might have skipped, but you know, it's a food for thought. You also can think among, and you can also share your views with us. So, and organizers will definitely share our email IDs with you. So we can definitely, you know, receive your, you know, questions through the email. So thank you very much, Joyjit sir. You know, we are wonderful, you know, both of us, you know, we are very much delighted in getting this wonderful opportunity to speak in the Global Edu Conclave 2021 organized by, you know, Green Thinkers and I2R. So we are very thankful, you know, to them.
Yes, sir, for your active participation.
Yes, sir. Thank you. We are open to any sort of suggestions, comments from your ends.
Yes,
all of you stay healthy, stay safe during this COVID situation, you know, tough times. We wish good health for all of you.
This is all. This I also wish the same from my side.
Namaste.